A through F this month. A is Joe Miller, who is a teacher of the Wilson Language Program. That's a reading program that we use throughout the schools. Her rate is $50 an hour, and that is the same cost as last year. And this contract has been reviewed by the same period, same contract as previously. B is Overbrook School for the Blind. This is for a special education aid for a student identified as 20/20/08. The cost for this contract is $40,500 for the school year, and last year's cost was $39,600. The next contract is Keystone Freedom Academy. This is for special education services, and the cost for this service is $250 per day. And again, this contract is reviewed by the solicitor. C is Curriculum Designs Incorporated, professional service workshops for staff development. Cost is $14,700. We're using Title II funds, which is our federal dollars for that are allotted for teacher training. So this is one of the programs for our teacher training this year. This is curriculum design under the Habits of the Mind program. And then the second part is a contract with Ben Cowick. This is also a contract for the professional development for the year. We're also using Title II funds for this contract, for our federal dollars for teacher professional development. The cost of this contract is $12,000, and this one also has to do with the Habits of Mind professional development.
Excuse me, if you remember last night, those of you that were at curriculum, Dr. Scheid spoke about the Curriculum Innovation and Design Council. Mm-hmm. So that's 45 members of the school community who are part of that design team, from administrators to teachers to counselors. And so these are two of the services we're bringing in for their professional development. And I believe they have, I forget if they have 4 or 5 dates for the year that are planned for that group.
Thank you. And the last contract we have this month is Chamber Theater Production for the Encore 2 performance in Allentown. This is for North Middle School students to go see the performance. Cost is $3,769.50. And this contract is being paid for by the students. For the students to be and that's it for contracts.
Quick question. So you had just mentioned the meeting times for under this last contract with Ben Cowick. So the three on-site workshops, so there's three on-site and then the other two are, did you say there was five?
Three? I forget if there's 4 or 5.
Okay, so I'm looking, it looks like there's three on-site. So September, there's one date in September, 2 in October. Then you have a virtual session. Is that accessible by every party? I mean, like,
so there are, that means there are 4 dates.
Okay.
Because the 3 dates she's actually going to be physically here.
Here.
The 4th date, this is the similar model they did last year. Last year there were 2 days she was on campus and 2 days where she was virtually.
Okay.
And so that's the 4th one that's there.
And
then the editing and feedback hours is actually, she is giving us feedback on our curriculum documents.
Great.
And so that he sent her that, and so then she, we have booked her a certain number of hours for her to review those to give the team feedback on what they're working on.
Okay, great. I just wanted that clarified.
Yeah, no,
thank you.
Thank you, Project.
Any other questions or comments? Can we move on to the budget calendar?
All right, so it's that time of the year again where we start to think about the budget again.
It's
here it is.
Never ending cycle. But it's better to be way out ahead of this than behind it. So what we usually talk about in September is the Act 1 timeline, where the preliminary budget is required versus the non-Act 1 timeline, where it's just both of passed the opt-out resolution, which says that we will not raise that in public. That second option is what this, we've done since the time we've been here, probably sometime before that. The preliminary budget timeline this year, we would only need to do that if we wanted to have the opportunity to submit to the E4 exceptions in the Act 1 index and to ask for a higher tax increase. If that was something that the board wanted to do. And normally the board would do that if they have some type of a building project going on, and they get revenue or some kind of economic need in the district that they lost a certain amount of revenue or something they need to catch up. Or if they had large out-of-control special education costs, and that is a way to ask for an exception to have to pay for those costs. Luckily, we have not been in that scenario in the recent past, and thank goodness for that. But so the Act 1 calendar this year is actually a little bit more progressive. Was faster this year because it is tied to the primary election in next spring, which being a presidential election year, state primary date moves forward about three weeks. We would normally have to pass the preliminary budget sometime third week of February. So next winter it's actually January 27th, which would put us in even a tighter crunch to try to develop the preliminary budget. Bring us to the board and have some type of an idea of what we wanted to do in that next fiscal year. We would, under that scenario, have the principal department heads have their budget in our county system by November 1st, which really is not that far away. And then we would walk through the steps, have a preliminary budget in January, and have a budget in May, passing in May, vote, and then final vote in June. So that's the first option. The second option, as we talked about, is that the board decided to go with the opt-out resolution and limit the tax, any potential tax increase to the Act 1 index. And we found out yesterday, it was posted by the state that the index or the base index for next year is 2.6%, which is a little higher. This year we were operating on 2.3, so next year we'll be operating under 2.6% base index. What we will do under this scenario is November 8th is when we release the budget information to the principals and department heads. We ask them to have their preliminary budgets in the system by January 6th, and then we start the process of reviewing all that information and having meetings with the principals and department leaders with the superintendent, and then we would start our budget meetings then new year, and we would have to, no later than December 3rd is when the board would have to pass the opt-out resolution unless the board wanted to have a special meeting, because the date is January 9th, our last meeting before that is December 3rd. Then we would move forward with a May budget passage for the proposed, and then the final budget passage in June, June 15th. And that would pretty much follow the same calendar that we just went.
So is there anyone is everyone comfortable then opting out and no, we're not going to raise taxes above the actual index, or is there anyone who feels like we need to have the ability to file for exceptions to raise taxes above the actual index? Everybody good with the we're not going to raise taxes above actual index? So then we'll move forward with that.
Okay, great. So then I will bring the resolution to you. state program, of course, is administered by the Pennsylvania Department of Revenue. The funds for the program come from the Pennsylvania Lottery and slot machine gambling proceeds in order to make the gains back to the taxpayers at the state level. There's a household income limit of $35,000, so you have to be below that limit at the state level in order to apply, in order to receive a rebate from the program at the state level. To be eligible, you have to be 65 years or older, or you are a widow or a widower, at least age 50, and your spouse who was deceased was 65 at the time of their death.
Is that basically to say if they were eligible for the program, you don't lose eligibility if they pass away?
Correct.
Is that basically what they're saying?
Grandfathers them in to the program. And unless
no pun intended, with grandfathers them in. Okay, just check.
I'm just not that smart. That does go away if you say if you remarried someone under 65, and you lose that.
Got it.
And you would have to wait and qualify again. Also, age 18 or more permanently disabled allows you to enter the state program as well. So at the state program, the rebates range from a high of $650 down to a low of $250. And those rebates are based on a sliding income scale. And it's based on the total income in the household. So everybody who lives in the household, you have to include their income. And it also includes half of a person's Social Security income and any other income, any other unearned or earned income that you might have. Individuals complete a PA Form 1000 and submit that to the state. And so for the year 2018, those applications go into the state and they have to be in by June 15th to June 30th of the fiscal year in order to get the rebate for the previous year. This is the sliding scale that we talked about. So if your income is zero, $8,000, you could potentially receive a $650 rebate, $8,000, $15,000, $550, $8,000, $8,000, $8,000, $8,000,
So you talked about the completing the PA form 1000. Is that an annual application?
Yes.
Or is that a one time?
Annual application. So when we looked at the Northern Penn School District's program, again, it's based on the existing state program, so it's a model of the state program with some changes. They began the North Penn in 1819 school year. And what they did was they issued like a 25% rebate, 25% of the state rebate to qualifying homeowners. So if you were in the $650 rebate category, they would give you 25% of that $650. And so in 1920, they're increasing that 25% to 30% of the state rebate number. So they're increasing their program a little bit. They do have documentation and application that has to be submitted to the district, and that's due to the district by June 30th.
Is it an annual?
Again, an annual program. And the North Penn program has been approved by the district board each year. They've decided on an annual basis whether they want to continue the program. So at North Penn, their maximum rebate in 1819 was $163, which is 25%. And this year it was $195, which is 30%. They have about 450 applicants in 1819 and issued 35,577 rebates. And the 450 applicants are about 29 or 30% of what we saw when we looked at the state. they are expecting, when I talked to the business manager later, they're expecting a higher participation rate in 1920. The first couple of months, their numbers are certainly higher than they saw in the first year. So this is what the North 10 numbers look like at the state level. The number of claims that fall into each category and the amount of state rebates. So they have a total of about 1,500 people, almost 1,600 people at the North Penn School District that apply at the state level. And again, they got about 29% of that applied at the district level. And at the state level, they got about $500,000 in rebates back to the taxpayers. But that's the state. Our next key thing, school district that we took a look at was the Chamois program. The Chamois is a long-running program. I think back to the 1970s.
Mm-hmm. 40 years.
The Chamois refunds based on 7 income categories, so they spread it out a little bit more than the state. They also require an application be submitted by June 15th, plus the backup documentation that approved what's on the application. In 2017, they had about 227 claims at the district level, which was about 20% of the eligible people. When we looked at the state numbers, and in 2016, they were 236 claims. So their data is usually in that 220, 230, 240 range that we looked at for the last few years. These are the Chamois numbers at the state level. About 1,000 or 1,100 people apply. About 377 to 378,000 in state rebates. In 2017 data is the last data, the most up-to-date data on the state website. This is Pennridge 2017 state data. That Pennridge had about 811 people apply at the state level, and the state did rebates in fact for $267,000. You can see the number in each different categories.
We shared the North Pennridge and the Chamonix state numbers to give you a sense for magnitude. Right, basically we are half the number of Penn's claimers,
right.
And the Chamonix have them. Kind of be a sense for the state claims as we think about what the impact might be in Pennridge. And also looked at their claimant percentages to kind of estimate what that would be.
That makes sense relative to their population.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
It's not a one-to-one ratio, but it's certainly pretty close.
Sure. Yeah.
So we took a kind of model or scenario for Pennridge based on the information that we just shared with you. We have 811 total participants at the state level, and we estimate that 50% of those eligible at the state level would eventually apply here at Pennridge. Also, show a rebate estimated average state rebate of $450. And if we follow the North Penn model at a 25% state reimbursement, it would be about $132 per rebate. So the rebate estimates would be, so 406 applicants, assuming 50% of the 811 at the state level, 25% of the 450 would be $113 rebate. That would be a cost of about $45,378 estimate. If all 811 people submitting, it would be about $91,600. Based on the 25%. And then the rebate cannot be more than the average taxes that might be by the taxpayer. If you would go back into the state numbers and actually do the division, it doesn't always work out correctly. And it's because there are people that will actually receive less than they didn't actually pay the most taxes. But they may have applied about $50 a month to an income. So that's why I actually said those numbers don't actually apply.
Questions or comments?
I think they certify and then give certain percentages of to various entities, the homestead, farmstead rebates that we receive, or at least
it's
many members of the public qualify for it, receive. So it seems to me like this is a zero-sum game, in a sense, right? That that lot of money and a lot of school districts with this program is on the intel. I'm sorry, the Inquirer had an article just this week, I think, concerning this program, or these programs, and talking about interest in various school districts in the Philadelphia area, Pittsburgh area.
Is it? It's not, I think I don't know if I understood you or what you were saying, part of it. I think you said it's a zero sum game for possibly the not be.
No, no.
The state's not being
at the state level, it's a zero sum game. There's a finite, whatever the money each year is that gambling raises is what's available to all those entities. And as we've seen, the Homestead and Farmstead Act is not the same number year on year.
Correct.
It's similar, or has been over quite a number of years, but it's not the same. And I believe that depends on that amount of money that's received, as well as if we get more people who apply or fewer.
The school district's homestead, farmstead money to get back to the taxpayers only comes from the gambling funds.
And this does too, correct?
This comes, as we understand, from the PA lottery and the gambling. So there's two.
So now there are two unknown.
Yeah,
this is another factor.
Right, at the state level, there's two revenue sources for this program. Where for our program, homestead, farmstead, it's just the gambling. And they do certify that each year, and it's actually budget counter. There's a time of year that that's certified at the state level, and then they tell us how much that money number will be, and we can put it into our budgets.
What I like about this is that the people who are presumably struggling most to pay their taxes are the ones who get this benefit. The homestead, farmstead, anyone qualifies no matter what their income or wealth is.
That's true.
So, you know, yes, if you make $500,000, you get $200 back if you apply. If you make $5,000, you get $200 back, and it makes a big difference in those accounts, I'm sure.
You're correct.
So did I understand right that only North Penn and Neshaminy are the local school districts that have their own programs in addition to the state program?
No, I learned this morning that Palisades has been doing this for a long time, with a caveat that they model it off of this program, but they also attach it to volunteerism. And there are, if you remember back in the spring, I think it was Mrs. Cullen who had gone to maybe PSBA and had seen, I don't think it was Palisades, but she had came back and talked about
Downtown.
Was it Downtown? Okay. She had talked about a model where there was volunteer rebates. Was it NSBA? And so, and she had talked about that. And so Palisades does a little bit of both. Where Palisades still does it for seniors, but it's not simply based off of income. Income is the first hurdle, and then the next hurdle is there's a minimum number of hours that you or a family member have to give to be able to receive their income.
So
the other
thing, when you're comparing the two models between Neshaminy and North Penn, and obviously this scenario that we're looking it's more predictable financially, because if you look at the numbers that you can get from the state, Neshaminy's model, you would have no way of predicting how much money it would cost you to budget for until after at least your first year of doing it, because the data isn't specific enough for their category, for the kinds of categories that they have. Where with Neshaminy, you're taking a flat percentage, it's 25%. And so it's easy to then take the state number and take 25% of it, as opposed to having the variability, and you don't know who fits into what category, so you can't quantify how much those, you have no idea how much it would be. And so from a budgeting standpoint and making sure that we can reasonably assess how much it's going to cost, that makes more sense. And then obviously you start out with a baseline, and then you can reassess, and you can always expand and increase the program, but the first year, you know, we have a pretty good idea based on using those state numbers, but you can never predict with 100% certainty what those numbers are going to be. And so after the year, you get a pretty good baseline, you know, to be able to make additional decisions in the future. So, I'm sorry, Sherry.
I had a question for Mr. Dalbert. You said that it's on our budget calendar.
It might not be. On the Act One timeline calendar, on the May 1st is when the notification is already available to swap.
Okay. All right. Well, that's good. Thank you. I just wanted to have an idea of when that information becomes available.
I think it's important with this type of program that we implement it to make it as simple as possible. I mean, these folks are seniors, and they're not our wealthiest seniors, so you know it's hard to get things accomplished like that. And I presume that's why the number of applicants in these other districts are low, right? 29%.
Right.
Because it's I don't know how difficult it is. As I understand, the North Penn program is not terribly difficult. It follows the state model in terms of the application process. That would seem to me to be the best method to try to keep it. I mean, it may not be simple because the state doesn't.